that's burning.
So you have to carry your book bag and your gun?
Yeah. Cool. That's what I do every time I go hunting. And until we get to the trail, my ski. Bring that pad if you wanted to see that.
No, it's fine.
She says she's fine now. All right, Molly, be good to you.
It's all locked.
Gotta be. Just hit the bush. Just coming in on the trail here. There's proof that there's rabbits around. And anyone says rabbit foots are good luck, I'll ask this guy. It doesn't look like it helped him out much. Probably lynx or something got him. So we're out here on the trail, and I forgot my regular mittens at home, apparently, trying to find all this other stuff and bring it with me. So, yeah, I guess I'll be wearing my clunky mittens. Hopefully I don't get to any quick shoot. All right, we'll see you once Barbara's done playing with her rabbit foot.
It's dry and yucky.
It's frozen.
Looks like he got bit all here too.
So here's the hawks. I figured I'd show you guys what it's like for putting them off and on. Yeah, the buckles are on this side. It's pretty easy. Unless you got a bum knee, I guess. But you just get your toe and your heel in. They seem to have really good bindings compared to like some cheap stone shoe bindings. There's the toe and the heel. And the buckles are actually metal on them too, which is nice. I'm sick and tired of the world full of plastic. That's it. Do the other one. This one I had together just because I was trying different boots on it. And it's cool. It's got a free heel on it, so your heel can go up and down, but it's also spring loaded. So it fits on there nice and tight and moves with you. I noticed last time one of you guys commented about the price on here too. For me, it's definitely cheaper than a snow machine. And it's good exercise. And so far it seems pretty reliable. So. Time will tell, I guess. We're ready to go.
Bare open stuff here. Now mind you, it was wet and froze up again, but I'm not sinking at all. He took that out. It's noisy because of the ice. But...
what? Happy as the proverbial pig. Other than the ice. Snow machine tracks are not fun, but we'll get the bush here. Off track pretty soon. See you a bit.
Loose and hanging there. Yeah, it turned out good outside today. I almost feel overdressed. I don't think I need long johns. Especially not working. Guys, there's the skis. They got a little too crusty and too icy. And that's just the time of year it is. This is probably the worst time of year for traveling. I mean, the snow machine tracks here, they're certainly packed nice and hard. But yeah, to go off it, you're still up over your knees, almost to your waist in snow, but with crust on it. So, oh well, I'll just enjoy the scenery and have a little cookout here somewhere. was one of the trails we did ski lopping on last week. That I haven't been back here since before the snow until then, so yeah, it's a nice spot though. See the occasional wolf track and stuff, so but yeah, it's definitely not good traveling sort of conditions unless you're on trails. Just looking for spots to set up here, and up on top of this hill, there's an old tripod, like a teepee frame, just kind of poking its way through there. Barber's playing around with her kit there. Yeah, a little bit dead standing wood here, but I think we'll find a good spot further up. Not many critters though. This is why you should always take your wife with you in the bush. She's got a good eye. Saw these three guys. Yeah. Instead of having soup, vegetable soup, we're going to have ptarmigan soup. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. She sounds so excited. And what did you think they were?
Bunny rabbits.
Yeah, those are bunny rabbits. Well, I'm glad she saw them because I might not have saw them right away. I was busy checking other stuff out. I was looking for a good place to set up here and maybe some resources. So, yep. Cool beans. We'll see you guys when we get to our spot. Alright guys, so we got to see if I can find one without a broken leg here, because that'll impede things. I'm going to show you a quick and easy way that's almost guaranteed to work with gross. You'll find ptarmigan, it doesn't always work as good. If you've got a weak stomach, this would be a good time to quit watching. If not, then you should be alright. So, you can pluck the whole thing. There's people that do that, and I used to roast them whole and stuff. But the only real meat that's on them in any sort of amount is on the breast. So you're going to take your bird and lay it head away from you. And you open up his little wings here. And you're going to want to put your foot on the wing as close to the body as you can get on each side. Pull them in snug, get that tight. And you're going to want to grab both feet, and don't just grab them up here. I like to put his ankle, well, I guess you'd call his ankle, in my pinky, and then grab that whole leg all the way up. It's going to be noisy, and you don't want to just jerk on him and pull it. But what you're going to do is you're going to pull nice and slow and use your back muscles and your legs and just kind of stand yourself up again. So, like I said, it doesn't always work with these guys, but gross, I'd say 99% of the time it does. Let's see. Yep. So there's half a bird, which I don't like leaving stuff on the trail where people are like, oh, look, that's gross and stuff. Now, we did just have a raven going around, but I'll dispose of these somewhere where the animals can eat them, but where it's not going to make us look bad as far as outdoorsman goes. So at this point, now there's a gizzard and stuff in there too. Some people eat that and harp. So now we've got the breast already on the, you can come in for a closer look too. So here's your breast meat on the breastbone. The crop, you don't want to open that up if you can help it. If you already shot it, then yeah, you're going to have to just deal with that. And the gloves, I'm not scared of getting my hands a little gooky and stuff. But you'll find, well, I mean, you don't want to get sick either. That's one thing. But in the winter, wet hands equals cold hands. So if you can keep a barrier between blood and moisture and all that stuff, as soon as you're done, you can peel these off, put them in your garbage bag you should have with you. Or inside it with your meat even, I guess, worse comes to worse. But then you get dry hands, you can stuff them back in your mittens. So today it's not too bad, but there will be times. So I'm going to take our knife. Normally I wouldn't use my wood knife. I'd have a hunting knife on me, but this was kind of unplanned. So it's kind of like carving your Christmas turkey or your Easter turkey or whatever holiday you celebrate turkey. So here's your breastbone. Oh, and this cuts so much better when it's fresh like this. You're just going to want to keep going down, following that bone until you get to the ribs. I usually go underneath the old wishbone here a little bit. Oh wow, that's, you know, it's fresh when.
Oh, it's still, meat's still quivering.
So, can you see in there all right? I'm going to get a little... Oh yeah, that's still making all kinds of quiver in here.
Do you feel it when you hold it in your hand?
It's like salt and frog legs. That's the gizzard there. So yeah, there's still nerve endings there that are not liking that. Like I say, this isn't really a hunting knife, but it's going to have to do the trick today. And you just gotta cut all this meat away from the breastbone. I should lose. You guys get a really good look there. Yeah, it doesn't get much fresher than that. Now, it would be nice if we were home to be able to rinse it out and get any bloodshot meat out. Such is life. I'll have some hot water soon enough when we go to make some tea. There, that from forest to table, or in this case, it's going to be going in our pot. There's half a breast. And snow is usually pretty clean stuff, so put that there to cool off. You don't want it staying hot too long. So yeah, there's the gizzard. That's hard as a rock. And you'll find that's got all kinds of stone and sand and stuff in it. You can cut those open. I mean, you're going to want to use a knife if you're not worried about the edge. Cut that open and wash all that sand out and eat it, but all I bother with... What?
People eat that.
Oh, yeah. See that? Look, it's still moving. Anyways, I just thought I'd show you guys how to do that, because you can do the same thing, like I say, with grouse. My hat's crooked. And, yeah, we're going to have us some soup. You guys... Yeah, for the queasy ones out there, you'll be safe to watch again here in a second. Bad news on this bird. Where'd you put his feet?
I threw them away already.
So Barbara said, oh, I want to try this. And she stood on it, grabbed his feet, and pulled his legs off. So I guess there is a knack to it. But if you've got him, if you want to roast the whole thing, or even it's easier to open them up without the feathers in the way. So grab his wings and just kind of hold on to them behind its back. As long as you didn't blow the skin too hard with the gun, you should be able to just take all these feathers off. So if you wanted to roast this over a fire, that's the way you could give it that guy too. And that's just all the crop and everything up there. This is one of those things that's much more fun when it's not minus 40.
It's not minus 40 though.
I know, it's much more fun now. When it's freezing cold, the only thing that's going to get grip on this is your fingers, or in this case, a pair of gloves over your fingers.
It's raining feathers. Yeah. I'm standing right in the middle of it.
Down draft, and there's his little snow pants. They got quite a bit of feathers on their legs. So I'm doing this just to get the breast still, though. So basically, the whole bird would be the same. You would take it up to... I guess they'd be its wrist joints out on its wings and clip it off there and normally clip his legs off. Pretty much like a chicken leg, you would see those in the store and stuff, and go from there. So yeah, that's the other way you could do it. Grouse droppings. Grouse, not gross. Grouse, the bird. Yeah. Makes sense. We got lots of black spruce around. I found them in jack pine forests as well, too. Actually, the last two or three I shot were there. We'll keep on trucking.
Whoa.
You alright?
Yeah.
Like dinner, I'm still alive. Thank you. guys. So normally I'd use a ferro rod, but I want to show you something. I was watching Survival Russia, Lars's video, his last one there was his hunting camp. And he was having a hard time with matches, and a lot of people do. There's a right way and a wrong way, so this is just a pill bottle I repurposed to put some of the striker material in it, but I'm going to cut a piece of bike ring to make a rubber-proof gasket for it. Anyways, long story short, you'll see people. They'll use a match like this, and they'll keep trying to strike, and they'll either not strike good or they'll snap the head off and they get upset. And as soon as it comes out, it's in the wind, right? And right now it's a little breezy, but it's not windy. But what you want to do is actually hold your match like this. And then when you strike it, you can cup it inside your hand and protect it. And then if you've only got one match left, you've got yourself a fire. So let's see how that works here. I'm going to get some birch bark ready to go. So I do have a pocket full of that. More elastics too. Never seen a shirt with so much elastic in his pockets. Maybe even got a little bit more. Oh yeah, all kinds. So there's a birch bark. Now I've got my tinder all on top here ready to go just to pull ahead. Make sure these are dry. And one thing I did too that works good, I've got a piece of striker in there, but I put some in the cap too. So this is going to be a little different than when you see the box being used in normal sort of fashion. But make sure your hands are dry, which means you want to use your dry pant leg. So like I said, and that's why my match isn't upside down so the head doesn't strike down my bag. So I'm just going to get inside here and guard it. Oh, and then transfer it over when your flame's nice and strong on your match head, and away you go. Instant fire. Pull our tinder over. And that's going to burn down through there and make a nice coal bed, and we'll be good to go. Yeah. Fire's a lifesaver up here, so if you've got matches, make sure you learn how to use them and practice it. So, just melting down some snow here to make our soup. Got a little bit of wood, I'll probably have to get some more. Got Barbara, see the rest of her camp here. Got a kit, oh, that's deep. Our kit's all along here, and yeah. So this is the snow that's already been squashed down, it's up past my knees still, so. No shortage of snow. It's just kind of crusty and rotten on top. It's going to be some good soup. And what is on today's menu? Let's see. So, in here, we have some split green and yellow peas, split red lentils, pea barley, rice, some beef stock. Why does that not want to focus, huh? And some frozen vegetables, green and yellow beans and carrots, and debating whether or not to put the ptarmigan in there. I might just take that home, we'll see. Yeah, but that's the main course. As soon as this melts down enough, and keep putting a little bit of snow in there, it'll melt quicker once there's some water forming in the bottom. And then we'll have us a little meal here. Hey guys, I've had people mention I never see you using a saw. I sometimes use one. And I've seen so many people say they're going to saw this up into firewood. Then they hold on to it here and do their thing, or they're standing up and stuff. I want to show you guys something that is a pretty old trick. I've heard it called the plumber's vice, but I'm sure it has different names. If you're cutting with your right hand, put your right leg over this, and then you'll use your knee almost like a vice. Oh, I burnt my pants. And then clamp down on it and work it against this knee, if you can see that. So there's a couple of things. Now my femoral artery is on the inside, so even if this was going to slip and do any sort of damage, it's not going to cause me to bleed out. But now I just sit here and just do my thing. Now this is why I don't use a saw, because this seems like it takes more effort than first. I'm going to pull it through and grab onto the tree with your legs again. There you go. Not the world's most expensive saw. Let's do one more, I guess. Same thing. And you could even saw this till it's not quite all the way through, but if you did that on your whole log all the way up through, when you're done, just snap them all off.
Just thought I would share that with you.
Keep starting. See you at the fire.
So the dry ingredients and the stock are in it. And once that's been softened up and turned into food, we'll throw the veggies in and call it good. What's Barbara think of it?
It's good.
Yeah?
Oh yeah, I really like it.
Hmm. What do you get on your head?
Oh, a buff.
Yeah, but where's it from?
Lord of the North.
And what do they do?
They make mukluks and moccasins, and they give all their patterns away for free. They have
free's
patterns to make sleds.
So yeah, since I got myself a Frontier woman now, she's doing all that stuff, so. Yeah, check those guys out. Just lordofthenorth.com, is it?
In Ontario.
Good Canadian company. Ain't much left of our old fire here.
Oh, hot shot.
Is it warm?
Yes.
Does it taste good, though?
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's good. I'll quit filming you eating this. So, camp's cleaned up. Looks kind of crummy, though, because the ground's all stomped out. But another few weeks, that won't matter. Barbara's all nice and cold, ready to get hiking again, make some heat here, and get the skis packed up on the bag, and ready to hit the trail. So thanks for joining us for another episode of Bushcraft North of 60. With runny nose and Aaron here. You guys take care. We'll see you again. Right here from the Northwest Territories, Canada.